Welcome to the talk and video screening. The Retrat d'Artiste Urbain. Oh, is it the
Catalan version?
The Catalan version, okay.
Micro?
The micro?
You have to push the button, I think.
Is it working?
No?
Yeah.
Ah,
okay.
Good.
It's better?
Thank
you. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Hello? My name is Robert Kaltenhäuser. I'm also going under the moniker Unauthorized Art Critic. You can find me in the social media. I self-appointed critic for unauthorized art, and of course unauthorizedly self-appointed to do that. A few words about myself. After a little bit of mingling with the urban art graffiti itself in a practical way, I also found some interest a few years ago in writing about it in an art philosophy way, in an art critical way, and also engaging in curating and theoretical accompany of the art form in a broader sense, but also very specifically in a certain niche that I call alternative graffiti, which for me means sticking to the method of graffiti without the aesthetic and content-wise conceptual restrictions of graffiti writing. Some funny people called it street art on trains or something like this, which is a nice way of getting the idea, but it's not only on trains. And it's, of course, embedded in a broader historical context. And this broader historical context is especially interesting to research, to find out, to engage with, to examine. So that's what I'm pretty much occupied with for a while now. So this kind of writings is piling up from that, mostly dealing in one way or another with these related topics. So tonight we are exploring the relationship between urban art. Let's not discuss too much about the terminology problems, because that's a hell without exit. But street art graffiti, urban art, roughly speaking, and alongside the works of three particular artists who are also in the show in the Rare Circle Artistic downstairs, and two of whom are also present for you to harass with questions, maybe afterwards. And the artists are, as you can read, is Shiwan, Dunja Jankovic, and Collettivo FX, who sadly had already to go back to his home of Italy. But we're going to start the video screenings with that. All these artists, so that's not them, but all the artists we're talking about are interesting because they work out on a different aspect of a very minimalistic, unusual, inventive, and therefore I want to argue a very sustainable take on unauthorized public art. An art form which has a very interesting history. The history, let's say, can be mostly traced back to early forms in a kind of first wave in the 1970s and early 1980s, with prominent examples like, for example, the shadow man Richard Hambleton, whose artwork is also part of the show, and similar similar experiments by artists who went took on the streets mostly with a conceptual art background, with a institutional critic kind of background, to bring the art into the public space, in the very same time that the other big unauthorized public art form, which is New York graffiti writing, New York subway writing movement, developed to its like full blossom form that we know today. So these two things happened kind of the same place at the same time, while also for the early street art, the pioneering street art, you find examples also in mainland Europe, for example, Harald Nagli, Black Levant, more isolated people from different backgrounds. But you can I think you can say it's like two distinctive movements. As we all maybe know, the New York subway graffiti movement, the name writing, coming tag piece throw up, as some theoretics call it, or Volvo, writing on walls and objects, as another theoretic calls it, has since spread worldwide, and around the millennium, or during the mid to late 90s, sparked a new wave of street art, as it was called again, by the practitioners, until some became boring of the terminology and then get in the head of the terminology again. So I've just picked a few picture examples which are absolutely not time related. They are from absolutely different different decennia, but the lower two, the Richard Templeton and the Basquiat, when the very famous Jean-Michel Basquiat was still doing illegal street graffiti, conceptual poetry under the name of Samo, with his partner Elias. So I picked the picture material for the minimalism, and for the demonstration how actually in a minimalist take, combination with the urban surrounding can be maybe even more effectful than a super effectful take, which just covers up whatever context there is. So I find that the artists that we are talking about today are all more or less falling in this particular corner and take on a minimalism. This is you see the cover of the book Street Art by Alan Schwarzman from 1985, which is a big recommendation by me to just find out about the early street art scene that was present in New York during the 80s, and of which Hamilton and Basquiat and Herring and Jenny Holzer and all these people were a part of, and how they are actually not what later become like just a focus on Herring and Basquiat as a so-called graffiti artists, but which was more like a conceptual art in the street, alternative people doing alternative things and so on, and how they were all aware of the writing scene happening at the same time. It's a very brilliant book, especially the essay part, and I'm also pretty proud that we were able to reprint the essay part completely in this publication. So if anybody is interested to read it, I will be able to provide. Then a few more examples of alternative and abstract, either abstract or figurative graffiti, which is one artist from Germany, Tosca, is the train under the bridge. not part of the show. Then we have one work which I find very brilliant from Kenor, who's part in the show, but with a sculptural work. He's a very early pioneer and very important figure in my opinion for abstract and unusual alternative graffiti coming from the growing out of the writing scene. A phenomenon which happened more or less in parallel to the new street art, and which I find personally it's also can be seen as a little bit more sustainable way in hindsight after 20 years of following these art forms, particularly because the people who were more connected to the graffiti scene, to the train scene, even if they went with their art into really abstract forms, really going away from the concept of writing, the faith of graffiti, I have to paint my name and stuff. Also the stylistic elements, even though there are a few, this transition is more light. As there are still like color fields and outlines, but I mean this is in painting in general. And the last picture is the first picture of the first video that we're gonna see. It's the concept Cargo Jindu by Collectivo FX, the first of our three artists that are part of the screening. The concept is easily explained on a basic level. So Collectivo FX goes to train yards where container trains are parked and paints either on the light container with a dark color or on the darker colored container with a light color, portraits of series of hundreds of historic figures. He started in around 2010 with Chinese emperors. Then when the Chinese emperors, all the almost 100 Chinese emperors that were available visually out of history were gone, he opened the next bottle, which was a bigger one, which was philosophers. But there is not only Jindu 1 or Jindu 2 as in the picture, but there's Jindu 3, 4, 5 and 7, which are serious. That I don't even all know which are they. I know that there are migratory animals, Sirius, and a few others. So it's just masses. It's absolutely coherent with the concept of graffiti bombing. Just I mean, you would be maybe a king bomber if you did only like a third of the amount of in throw-ups or tags in a city that this artist done. It's very interesting also to know that Collectivo FX does not come from the graffiti writing, comes from the let's say regular contemporary art, very classic painting figurative art, being in galleries at one point. As a political thinking person, gets very bored by this and very like annoyed by the simple commercialism and the felt meaninglessness of all this, and got in touch with writers who were doing roller piece blockbusters and stuff, and just introduced a little bit the techniques, and then completely took over and like went just madness with this thing. When thinking like what to do, because we actually don't have a video by Collectivo FX, there is no video, it's just this, the only thing that exists are the millions of snapshots that are circulating on the internet or social media. So what to do with that? But maybe one of the first encounters I had with this artist group was when I wrote an essay about them for a magazine, which should be the third edition of Zugriff, a magazine that we make since a few years, but the third edition never came out for several reasons. I mean, the several reasons are the other publications that are visible here. So I decided to, it might be nice to just read the essay and have the visuals accompany it, and I hope it can make some sense. The essay is titled with two Chinese characters, but they translate Jindu, and Jindu again translate as progress. So let's go. Meet Andrew Bryson. He works as a longshoreman in the harbor of Baltimore. He describes his fashion attitude as doesn't matter as long as it has reflective. He likes big ships with big anchors. He fucking loves the waterfront, as well as those fast and expensive cars, which he photographs by the dozens in the storages of container ships while at work. He likes splatter pics, heavy metal, and posing like a rapper. He likes dogs, hunting, fishing, and all kinds of machine guns, which he regularly fires on Sundays. To him, Sunday is gun day. And firing makes him feel like I'm Steven Seagal, heavy barrels and red dots. Besides that, he is a fan of the right-wing fringe figure, reality television celebrity and rock musician Ted Nugent, famous for relentless rants against communist-raised, communist-educated, communist-nurtured, subhuman mongrels, and his stance that South African apartheid wasn't all that bad because all men are not created equal. Bryson also likes seafood and burgers. Andrew Bryson is an active skateboarder and an outspoken fan of illegal graffiti. Graffiti. Yeah, man. I see so much artwork on train cars at work. This stuff's amazing. It is interesting to be able to get this close to knowing Andrew, a young man who somehow seems to maintain a sense of self amongst today's contradictions while proudly fulfilling his destiny as a cog in the big machine clearing the ships from goods that circulate the global trade routes. I think he's still in Baltimore. I do not know Andrew Bryson. All the above information was rather effortlessly gathered sitting in my laptop within little more than an hour, starting from a single picture. This must be called progress. Bryson does his casual train spotting of North American freight train graffiti while working his shifts at the harbor. Like those of cars, guns, fish, food, concert tickets and skate tricks, he shares the graffiti pictures he takes on social networks. And regularly, he'll receive something in return. Cheery responses from the writers who applaud his decent shots of their work. On a sunny summer's day in 2017, Andrew Bryson captured a rather unusual piece of graffiti. Painted with black enamel bucket paint on a rather unusual support, a yellow MSC group container. It was a portrait of a Chinese emperor accompanied by the word Jingdu, subtitled Imperator Su Container, numbered 72. In Gothenburg, dog worker Dick Didriksen encountered a similar painting on a container owned by Danish business conglomerate Maersk while on duty and took a photo out of the driver's cabin of the reach stacker he is paid to operate. Benny Rodriguez, whose occupation could not be disclosed that easily, captured another one in Miami. Then he came and then he name-checked the originators, uploaded the picture with his mobile device and sent it to the creators via a social media platform with a note. Some of your work, seen in Miami. Two global networks are at play here, the interplay of which arguably constitutes the dominant structure of today's social and economic dynamics. One of them, the one which enables our dedicated hobby photographers to share their crops, fuels worldwide dealings, commercial and otherwise, by providing the means for offers, orders, transactions and organization. When the payment has been transmitted, the other one provides the hardware to pass around the commodity countervalue. One is the electronic information highway, the other one is the logistical hardware track. Only in combination they unfold their full epoch-making impact. The factual phenomenon is undeniable, an international dissemination of container commodities, as well as an exchange of information through the internet, shaped the world of today. Just as the industrial age was defined by then newly developed means of production and the power structures around them, the current age of disinformation networks and radicalized one-click consumerism, even if it still carries concealed all the hardware functions of its predecessor, and therefore must be considered, for the moment, a modification rather than a revolution. The era is shaped by the material forces at play. One of them, maybe the most decisive, while least visible to the user, is the corrugated sheet metal standard box of dry freight shipping. Today's typical standardized trade container is built to suit the demands of intermodal shipping, a method of transport involving different types of transport. Therein, containers are transferred from trucks to trains to ships and any other way around during their respective transport chains. The global standard model is the 2 or 12 meter general purpose ISO 6346 container. Whatever that modern day worldwide economy needs, be it smartphones, sneakers, toys for kids, for adults, clothes, Pepsi, Coke, powders and shells of all kinds, cameras, instruments, infrareds and immigrants, most of these will at some moment travel inside one of the more than 20 million typical so-called sea cans that circulate the global trade routes. Many are lost at sea, never to be seen again. One could go endlessly from here, contemplating the ages that come and go, the empires that rise and fall, questions of progress and decline, and engines of survival. In short, all that überbau stuff fueling the imagination of partisans left and right, in conflicts continuously filling the pages of history, past, present, and future. We can watch a supposedly leveling homogenization under the banner of capitalist progress, paradoxically stirring up retreat or regression to identitarian sensibilities and thus politics on all sides of the spectrum. Twisted motives and shifting alliances make predictions a gamble and taking sides a pitfall. Still, sometimes one feels tempted to comment. The idea came about in an Italian train yard, where Collettivo FX had gone to paint. When we got in front of a container train, we thought, these must be Chinese containers. It became clear that China today stands as a symbol for merchandise, is a center of industrialization and export. It has become a pacemaker of progress. But don't you think it's strange that the world's oldest civilization, which is profound history and culture, is sending over the most definitely symbol of Western industrial progress? With all their history, can't they send us something else? So we decided to underline these contradictions by painting the historical Chinese promoters, which is the emperors, on top of the contemporary Western Chinese progress. We called it progress in the Western Chinese, Jindu. By the time we arrived at 100 emperors, we also got the first reactions to our Jindu. Some people just offended us, others freaked out, from North America, Canada and Northern Europe. Of course, we got nothing from isolated China, totally disconnected from the Western social media sphere. But we surely forgot something. This is a zone where there's a lot of exportations. Some things go to China and come back, but only a small part of it. Certainly, Collettivo FX have found an original lever on a practical level, but also used it to consequently come up with an unusually coherent series. Not only did they tap a rarely considered medium to the ends, the container seems everything a graffiti writer does not want to touch. It's not a train, not even a freight train, not an even support, totally overlooked. Moreover, they managed to use it to a fully compelling effect, aesthetically as well as content-wise and conceptually. On top of that, they did so with the most economical means imaginable, a bucket of cheap black paint and a brush. It is striking, well, maybe not surprising, to see such an advancement being explored by outsiders, who are neither writers nor street artists. Collettivo FX came, saw the blank and occupied it. The collective was founded in Reggio Emilia, a small industrialized Italian region, in December 2010. Its members do not have a background in traditional graffiti. Before taking their paintings to public spaces and defacing private properties, they considered themselves normal painters working with galleries, but that was a bad situation. Everyone spoke intellectual, important stuff, but in reality the artwork was treated like furniture. Everyone in the collective felt a similar dissatisfaction. We didn't have a comfortable and air-conditioned office with a life contract. It was there we got the feeling that there are many contradictions and too little doubts. So when we took it... The text is a little bit too long. Let's start anew. I think starting from here will do it. Too little doubt. So when we took it to the street, we decided to work on contradictions in a way to put things in doubt. We started working along the highway in abandoned factories, on trains, the best places to feel safe and at the same time to feel the fear of the unknown. We moved around the region of the south where decisions are still made by real people and in small seaports of the north where trains arrive and leave to reach all over the world. We believe in quality, but mostly in quantity. Ethics is not meant to mean anything besides not meaning anything. X is to dismiss the notion of a name, and F even more so because it's a letter selected by random. In illegal painting, the collective state is strong influenced by writers because, as they explain, it was impossible to find other so-called street artists who really worked illegally. It was writers who taught them how to move around the city. What really struck them was seeing rollout blockbuster pieces that made entire walls simply disappear. Apart from graffiti, they mention other artistic influences like public city monuments and the Fluxus movement, namely with the likes of Dieter Ross. When we painted the train for the first time, it was because of Riot, a writer from our city. That happened 3 years ago. This year we had the idea to focus on containers, and from March until today, December, or was it then, we made almost 170 of them. By working with and about the current historic progress of the world, or the lack thereof, the collective have without a doubt contributed to the progress of our certain sphere of unsolicited art. It is clear, yet progress by definition cannot come to a halt. It would cease to be. Actually, we do not feel as graffitiers, even if what we do is illegal and it has to follow all the attentions a merchandise yard needs. But we prefer couriers. The idea of sending cultural exponents along with animals, food, tiles and balls excites us a lot. The next step will be to adjust the Jingu. We will take the Chinese origin off and will continue the work on the paradox of progress. And the biggest progress we can think of is the philosophical one. Although in wide circulation, not all of Collectivo FX emperors rule forever. Tyler Cameron from Etobicoke in Canada, who, according to his profile on a dating site, is really good at holding intelligent conversations on a variety of topics and probably other stuff, openly shares his opinion after he had been ordered to eradicate, or as we say, buff, one of them. Jindu, Emperor of Containers, is no more. I got paid to paint over your shitty art, you faggot. At Collectivo FX, hashtag bye bye Jindu, hashtag fuck right off with your graffiti, hashtag thanks for the paycheck though, asshole. So that was that, but as you could make out, it was written a few years ago, so the philosopher is already fully executed. But yeah, maybe it will appear in print someday. So the very interesting thing about the container concept of Collectivo FX is that at some point, just by having also a social media account, they got responses from a lot of harbor workers and container shippers who are mostly positive about it. You can see also in the exhibition downstairs, I guess maybe everybody already saw it, there is a lot of documentation from all kind of places in the world. And the artists are also really communicating back with the people who sent them the artwork. So, for example, the artists have hashtagged or tagged some of the harbor workers who sent the artworks in the installation in the exhibition, and as I've heard, one of them already wrote from Portugal that he was so excited about it that he plans to travel to see the exhibition in person while it's downstairs. So these kind of things are going back, and it's not even a hashtag what's written on the containers, but it's there. So I think all in all, I mean, I wrote the opinion in the opinion piece. it's one brilliant example of how to, with the very, very most minimal means, use the possibilities that unauthorized urban art offers in the to enter to hack into the networks of today's public transportation systems, goods transportation systems, infrastructure in general, to bring a message in circulation, to make a, in the end, it's like a worldwide land art piece, if you want to go that far. But by now we know that even a few of the containers were actually spotted in places like China. So it's really extreme example of what you can achieve with the most minimal means. Just going to one spot of freight train in some little small town in the middle of Italy, but with the right idea. Coming to the next one, there's not only the focus to spread into the systems, but with avant-gardistic minimal means, also the some artists can take on the aesthetic problems and the formal evolution, and that is sometimes a bit standardized in today's street art and graffiti, and doing so to arriving at some kind of next level, and remixing and reusing, so to say, recycling what's there actually in the art, and applying again very minimal means to achieve a vision that's turning things around and make you see kind of the underside or the backside of an idea. We have this example by Dunja Jankovic, who is present tonight. So all questions of concerning to the pretty controversial method of like abusing other people's art for your own could be also discussed with the artist directly. This photo is a very nice one because it shows the beginning of the process, the end of the process will be shown in the video, and I think without explaining too much, I can just let the video run and afterwards discuss a little bit about the process behind it and also the inspirations but also the implications of the process. So let's watch it now. Dunja Jankovic, whose first few seconds you've already seen. Thank you. Think that this is one of the most brilliant recent takes on formal and processive issues in graffiti as painting, but of course it's absolutely clear that this kind of process can be seen as very controversial from the point of view of the graffiti writing culture. Graffiti writing culture has a strong sense of ego. Actually, the painting can be seen as a placeholder for a personal ego. Like, that's what I write is me. On the other hand, it has a big sense of occupying space with this ego, and there is a certain very restricted codex, which I would say is comparable to some sort of honor culture, which in turn means that any visual covering or visual aggression is seen as an actual aggression, and translated in this way. On the other hand, there are some other complexities, like the question if it's, for example, a legal spot, a so-called Hall of Fame spot, where everybody is allowed to paint, or is an illegal spot where somebody already took a risk to paint, or it's an abandoned area where, like, all kinds of trash happen anyway. And so it's interesting to find something like this introduced by somebody who's, again, an artist not with a background in the graffiti scene, but coming from a background of graphic art, as you can see. And also, if you see the picture on the right side, it's an early work in the public space, which still works with printed paper cuts that were glued instead of this newer process with the masking tape and the actual paint, let alone the newest process with the actual research into the special details of the look of the pieces that were collaborated with. Also, it's kind of bold to see that actually I'm not even keen on these kind of topics, but if you want to go there and say then you have a female artist going into this very macho male culture, even if not 100%, and even going there with a serious self-titled collaboration without consent, which is easily interpretable as a rape joke. So that can without coming to any objective interpretation, which cannot be really concluded too quickly, apart from a personal opinion, but it's clear that this artwork raises questions and goes a step beyond, goes to a next level, explores something which is rarely or normally not explored, neither in graffiti or street art, even if graffiti and so-called street art have a little tradition of crossing out each other. But this is something different. And I know from another artist who has a similar kind of approach of half covering other people's pieces, but as an artist with a background in writing culture, for example, he would restrict this only to Hall of Fame, where he says it's legitimate to cover up, and would never do this in an illegal surrounding. But even there, people are or have proven to be way more offended when they see that somebody used parts, left over some parts of their piece, covered only halfway, but in a way that uses their piece to become something new, to be incorporated in a parasitical way into a thing that they were not part of, was way more offending for at least some than the simple cover-up that would maybe have more or not in the graffiti scene. So this kind of new thing that arises again is able to raise many unforeseen or not thoroughly explored questions with, again, a super minimalistic, super simple means and just a twist in the process, turning around the usual do's and don'ts that are given in the scene. And as I said, I know somebody from the scene who does a similar thing, but it's also part of the indication that it's interesting to have artists from outside the tradition to join the tradition in a non-traditional way. As much as I love the controversy, and as much as I think it's necessary, and as much as I think restrictive traditions of the usual should be broken in art, as much as I think that there are no morals in art and not actually real ethics in art, but it gets most interesting at a point where people not only transgress the fence to the train yard, but also transgress the fence, the imaginary fence to the not done. But on the other side, still graffiti culture in a way more unoffending way, of course, offers a big potential of the unexplored, also for people who are looking for a more transitional way, not looking for the offensive revolutionary turnover of the concept, but for a slight evolution. The last video screening today is also fully in the line of the minimal means, and by applying this this more careful and maybe also more aestheticized approach, she won, the artist in the picture. You can see there's still the very abstract formal touch is still derived from lettering, from a type of painting slash calligraphy approach, but let's say also reduced to the max, abstracted almost to abstract, and as we will see in the video, also applicable in a very fruitful way to highlight one more aspect that the illegal interventionist public painting offers, namely the a dialogue with the spatial givens of the urban, and also especially a dialogue with the spatial givens of the unused, of the abandoned parts of the urban surroundings, which are in this way again, coming back to the topic of the exhibition, again in a very sustainable way brought to a circle of recycling and highlighted and turned into visual poetry by a simple aestheticized gesture. So let's check out the movie of She Won, and after the movie that should speak mostly for itself. Don't run out, because Mark from Montana will be joining me for a little bit of discussion about what we have seen and what maybe else could be.
Thank you.
that was that. And if we sum it up, there was a lot of art done with very minimal means, a lot of idea, and a lot of impact in each their own way. So I think that's among other aspects, that's one quality that makes these kind of art examples also very, very much a way if we want to have art in a sustainable quality. I think the first don't is don't use too much resources, use what's there, and the resources have to be immaterial, and these are prime examples of used immaterial resources and minimal material resources to really big effect. Mark, are you joining me?
Yeah, sure.
Bring your throne or your chair.
I bring it, one.
Just a chair, not a throne.
This is Mark, the Armascore de Montana Colors. Culture department, so from this cultural point of view. Shall we follow in English or Spanglish or whatever you like?
English.
Because it would be nice also to do like some questions from the public. I mean,
is there anyone in the public who wants the Spanish version?
I think it's all English.
Okay. We'll continue in English. No, it's a very nice selection, it's a very nice example, but it's just opening up opening up the spectrum of graffiti. So it's widening a little bit the what we can imagine as graffiti when you think about graffiti or urban art or public art, let's say. It's a tricky thing, as you say, like this, use these words.
Yes.
I like public art in the end.
Most
of them is public.
Yes, and that's what it is in the end.
So you pick a very nice examples, and also the sustainability, it also comes in the concept itself of the words, not only in the use of or not use of materials, but the concept itself, it talks about the sustainability, how you can sustain a culture. Graffiti culture, is it sustainable itself? So many walls, so many tags, so many artists, writers, people, is this sustainable? So with this theoretical approach you're doing, you're putting this into question. You're putting this on, there is more life behind the classical graffiti with all these new approaches and all these very interesting mixing of contemporary art in public art and graffiti. I love the examples. Probably there are more other people, of course.
Yeah.
But they are very good. Very good pick.
Yeah. It's the pick from the selection, right, Jasmine? For sure, opening up to, I was just highlighting one aspect. And yeah, what's interesting is the thing that you mentioned is also going in with that polemic, like I like when stuff is covered, when things turn around the next level, graffiti scene is so conservative, let's piss somebody off, blah, blah. That's only one side, actually. You mentioned the sustainability of the graffiti. And of course, I think it's necessary, and we have to be honest to stress that it's an absolutely paradoxical relationship between the two things. I was just writing for the big book of Pietro Ivasi in Milano, also about the new waves, as I call it, of the alternative graffiti that go away from the name and stuff. But on the other hand, the relationship is not one-sided. There's not like the stupid variety scene was conservative and stuff, because it's it works in reaction. It works. It grows out of there. A good deal of the people they were not in the examples too much. I mean, she won is like this. People who go abstract, who look for new ways, are deeply rooted in the culture and would never have become artists in the first place without the lure and the attraction of the culture to them as kids in the first place. So all this culture that you're catering to, the Montana cans and all this stuff, I also don't see it as something that just has to overcome. We have to admit what it's bringing in the first place, and also that these people growing out of it are, again, keyword sustainability, they are also proof that it's a culture capable of renewing itself.
Exactly.
Growing.
I mean, yes. I imagine it as a tree with new branches, but also new roots. Because some of the projects we see, they deeply rooted in, I mean, you can find references from other artists that are not even related to public art in these works. So
yeah,
it is a very interesting approach, and it makes this the whole scene in a way like growing, which is very interesting.
Oh, that's a beautiful picture. The branches and
the new roots.
That's exactly what happens.
Because you dig in the roots, so you get these new branches.
Yeah, yeah. But also you like connect. Just make me think, because it's right like this. It's imagine somebody from the new wave of street art that came completely out of writers who went into logo text and stuff like this, and by doing this, by following an impulse and some kind of an urge to develop from the graffiti writing, made them reconnect with other older predecessors and pioneers.
It's like collectivo effects. This is mail art.
Yes.
It has a relation. If you do like a metal map or an artistic map, it has a direct relation with mail art.
Yeah.
So this for us as a brand, I mean, now I have to talk also a little bit as a brand, is so interesting. It gives us like a wider approach of the possibilities and the transformation power of public art, and that is not all. We love graffiti. We push graffiti as much as we can. We push street art as much as we can, and urban art. But this is a step beyond. Okay, to see how. It can be interpreted, and it can be worked with. I mean, it is very inspiring.
As you say it, I mean, original graffiti writing in New York subway was a type of mail art too.
They spread the five boroughs.
Spreading
for the five boroughs. Yeah,
and it was an absolutely avant-gardistic moment then. And it's also the strength that it's so much like copied or just kept. This formula can also be interpreted as a proof, of course, that the avant-gardistic moment then had so much quality. Mm-hmm. Because coming up with the concept that after that is copied by the whole world, it's also amazing thing. Mm-hmm. But talking about you as a brand, as a supplier of materials, so educate us how you also supported this project, because I don't know anything about it. I mean, you know, Jasmin knows, but...
Well, no, this very project, Drap-Art, it's already been 25 years.
But have you been...
Supporting sustainability.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So for us, it wasn't the right occasion to just to to get on board, especially when we also share certain values like the sustainability. I mean, we do believe and do actions in order to recycle the cans, etc. And we try to also be in that idea of sustainability. And the rest came together with the creator ship itself. It put the graffiti as one of the subjects. So for us was the right moment to be involved. You know, then especially when you came and the possibility of having also like a Richard Hamilton piece, a Shiwan, Junka, I mean everything gets got together. Because it is true that it is a sustainable form of art or graffiti. I mean, I'm not sure that this is a hell of a topic. If graffiti is art, or we should discuss also the limits of it. No, that's a tricky. But it is of course an artistic expression.
Yeah.
So. And it's also like a way to offer to the public for us to show other things, more intellectual, more not that obvious as other kind of more regular festivals that our public is used to to know, no, in a way.
Yeah. I mean, if you keep the environmental aspect to the side a little bit for a moment. It's also very interesting how this graffiti thing is making art sustainable as a cultural activity for the people.
Exactly.
It's because it's the folk art aspect of it. About I'm not like down talking the folk art. It's not like, but because it's. A living thing, it's passed on. It doesn't have to be pushed by funding or something. In the more developed points, it is now also joining this whole cultural field. But
we have a Banksy exhibition right now in Barcelona that it's patronage and it's sponsor, or it's a project from the city hall itself.
Yeah.
So on one side, there is this big problems with the administration on how they deal with the street art graffiti, but all of a sudden they came up with this huge, big exhibition that of course they paid a lot of money to bring it here. So in the middle of this discussion, the projects like this and even in the editorial field, this is a way of sustain the art and sustain graffiti through documenting it. See, one thing is like the art itself being sustainable, and the other thing is how you sustain and how you document and how you keep it like alive through, for example, through the editorial, through archive, through videos, etc.
But in this extreme situation where you have this city council sponsored posh Banksy exhibition and at the same time the buffing in the streets, you could give another advice to a city council than doing this, no?
Yeah, no, we already talked with them in the opening of the exhibition. Like, guys, who advise you, you know? And it's a pretty nice exhibition, of course, but maybe things are and about to change and they can open up. It's always going to be like a complex marriage, you know, the institutions and graffiti and street art and this public landscape modification in this week, especially in this city.
Yeah.
More than in other cities in Europe. It's a quite conservative city.
But being from this city and being on the scene for a long time, you've seen both, right? You've mm-hmm. seen the liberal approach and the zero tolerance approach.
Yeah, we saw the liberal approach. We were talking about Kenor. We know Kenor also from the very beginning. They were that age, no? In the 2000s, were like, that was an explosion of creativity, and was like, and there was like tolerance, but then it came to this total censorship and fines everyone and tickets to everyone, and now they're still looking for the right formula through legal walls and some tolerance, but it's a very sleepy way.
Could you provide some ingredients for a better formula?
This, I mean, to add like added value, like in a cultural way.
On a political, social level, on the street level?
Both.
Administrative level?
Both. I mean, provide the administrative level, the people who decide, knowledge. I mean, it's not only just a deco. Or it's not only ego, but there is like some real artistic work in the middle. Yeah. Besides the power of the collective and the culture it creates itself, which is something to have into account as well, more and more. I mean, people paint, and there is, and you go to Tres Chimeneas, and it's every week, and it's activity, and the scene is there, but I guess it needs a more accurate attention and respect to the artists. Yeah.
What's the artists now? So if we said from the period of the last avant-garde, we have now grown out artists like Kenor. Mm-hmm. What artists are growing from this period now? Are they? Who will we see in 10 years' time in an exhibition that we say, oh, these people developed their art during the time of zero tolerance? What do you think there is?
Jasmine can talk about a lot of artists. I mean, there is a scene. Then,
yeah.
Of course, we can talk about Kenor, we can talk about Vanessa, we can talk about Arith. We can tell Antonio, I miles. There are not thousands of them, but there are a lot of artists that are developing their career through muralism, but also through other fields like galleries or, you know, more artistic approaches. There is hope.
Yes. Yeah. I would find it interesting to see if there. Because this generation that we are talking about, who are mature artists now, no matter if legal or illegal now, but the surroundings that they grew up in as artists were completely different ones. Mm-hmm. So do you think it has what kind of...
That it affect their work, yeah, probably.
Yeah. Can you see it already coming?
I see
from the new times.
When you talk about new times, rules are changing, but rules are changing at every scale. Society itself is collapsing, looks like. Because of a pandemic, and all of a sudden, rules are changing, so our rules are going to change too. And then probably public art rules too. I mean, we have like a couple examples here, like people that's making disruptive actions that we haven't seen before. So I don't know. I think it's a very interesting moment now to experience and for the artists themselves to reflect and think, and
Yeah, let's be curious. I'm curious again. Also, there was a point when I saw some pieces, and I thought, okay, I've been following conceptual graffiti for like almost 20 years, and okay, that's it. This can't be topped. I had this moment.
Yeah.
Especially when I saw some people like copying the new formula already. Okay. I thought that's, but now I see stuff coming up Well, okay, it's continuing.
I mean, it's continuing with a lot of labels. No? You talk about alternative graffiti. There is this graffiti-tourism. Or technological graffiti, or abstract graffiti. I mean, it keeps on going on and on and on. No? That means that people have this willing of like research and you know, trying to find like, new languages and experiment, which is good.
Maybe even more. No. Shall we open the discussion?
Please.
Somebody wants to join.
Antonio, you that have this huge access to
it's too big, the conversation is
we talk about that, we can just get very philosophical and very, but it's too big, and it's nice that it's big.
Yeah, it's great. I think the more people that is, as you said, no, like working on new things, on working, you know, like goes outside the line. We are talking about graffiti, you know, in Montana Colors we have this experience. So we started with a very straight clientele,
say that, yeah. Customers or
like
or
straight graffiti
writers.
The influence from New York and the North American scene, and it grows like a flower, no? With very different flowers, you know, like and styles and incense, interesting, and that's beautiful. So, yeah, I don't know, what can I say about that? I the last time I saw like something that was really impressive to me, it was the work of Maxime Drouet. You know him?
Who makes the train window installations,
yeah.
Kind of?
Yeah,
yes, I follow that.
He puts like sprays and then with on the windows of the trains, and then he take the windows, you know, and do exhibitions with those windows, you know. So, and that's fantastic. I like it. And there's a lot of people doing amazing things, you know. Now we have like the internet, and it's crazy. You know?
Yeah, that's another point. And how technology plays a role in the sustainability thing, and how important is, and how, I mean, there is no, nowadays you cannot understand the graffiti without the technology behind for in order to produce these documents or to sharing or even to making the sketches, etc. No? So this relation with technology, it's getting more and more important. This is then the technological graffiti itself. In Germany you have this bond Truluf, which is like using augmented reality related to some of their works. This is also like an interesting way. And yeah, let's see what the metaverse is gonna bring us.
Yeah, the technology is great.
How graffiti is gonna get involved, these NFTs, this.
I think the media is great because you can document all the process. You know, like 20 years ago, you only could see
when
like
you get the camera.
One lapse or just the final art,
yeah.
Or the beginning, or maybe one moment.
But was already related. I mean,
I'm
sure the people make the pictures with their regular camera, but of course it was like one of the objectives is to have the image itself.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, it was this kind of ephemeral public art is always, some are denying it, or some are denying it for themselves, or rejecting it for themselves. But on a broader scale, it's very much documentation related. It's in a marriage with documentation because it's in the moment, in the place, but to bring it out of the moment and out of the place to other moments and other places, it just relies on the documentation. Thinking of exhibitions and publications and all these things, and it's a natural, it's an absolutely natural relationship that also, of course, naturally grows. I don't know if anybody of you has seen the exhibition Viral Vandals in Eindhoven a few years ago. Mm-hmm. We made this nice interview with the curators, Good Guy Boris and Jasper van Es. It was completely about graffiti-related art that's working through social media or internet connections without abandoning the illegal graffiti side of things. So it was vandals, but they went viral. I mean, it's a nice telling name. They made the hashtag also, and it's apart from being one of the, if not the best illegal graffiti related exhibition I've seen, mm-hmm. because it was topical, it was really well made and everything. So kudos to the curators, super good. And it was also the first exhibition that I saw that was collecting strictly stuff that you could call conceptual graffiti, and you could see that much of it is actually related to experiments with the digital media, like mm-hmm. Navas Crew. I don't know if anybody knows it, Navas Crew from Belgium, they painted the piece, filming themselves with the action of painting their piece, censoring the very same piece with just a black field, becoming a very unusual piece of graffiti, then gluing a QR code beside it on the train. So you had the censored piece, the QR code, and a passenger could scan the QR code and see then the action of this piece and the final result of the piece. So these kind of things, having the actual graffiti like almost like New York somewhere in the foundations, but then building up on it with this kind of network experiments, and that was just one example of like 20. So these things are happening. I mean, Good Guy Bose himself is a prime example to this guy who's playing with the meme culture and all this stuff. But for some reason, it's still much rooted in the act of illegal painting too. No? It's somehow it's something like the a kind of legitimation. Almost.
You need the real base. It is not public art. I mean, it is public.
Yeah.
It is not graffiti. It's not.
Yeah.
It has to be related to the street,
yes.
to the public art.
Yes.
Loses the connection. No? Loses
yeah.
its personal, its credibility.
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking at one. I mean, that's a very extreme thesis, but maybe there's some proof to it. Because when it comes to subcultures and then dealing with subcultures in more official and more legitimized art contexts and more bourgeois art contexts like exhibition houses, official public museums and these kind of things, you always come to the point where it's like, yeah, but now it's the subculture is co-opted, it loses its core, it's like it happened with punk and hip-hop and these music cultures or some other youth cultures. And in some way you could argue that illegal graffiti is maybe in some way different in this respect. I feel that illegal graffiti can go into a very official exhibition house, in like this, for example, the German federal government exhibition hall. We had, for example, a video art by Moses and Tubbs, where painted with several painted whole cars and some like undercover performance kind of stuff. And as long as this is the core, as this is the foundation of the artwork itself, as long as the artist didn't say, that was in my past as a teenager, I did a little bit, well, I was a rebel, but now I do proper art. But there are a lot of artists who say, the real thing is happening outside, but it's also worth to make a kind of a translation in the art space in a conceptual way, in a documentary related way. Mm-hmm. It's to make the point, I think there might be a security against the full co-option. Because the illegal thing is still there.
Yeah.
It's not like a pop punk who just play with symbols. It's not only on the symbolic level. Illegal graffiti or unauthorized public art in general always is always able or is based on combining the symbolic level with the actual act. And this is something I think should not be underestimated. It's a particular quality that simply or only symbolic cultures don't have, cannot rely on, and make them easier to co-opt. And maybe that's a quality I want to highlight for sure. So.
What do you think about how the whole, the commercial graffiti and how all brands are like sort of adapting this language more and more, getting this mainstream approach of the graffiti and street art itself?
I mean, we live under the conditions of capitalism. It's all official art is dictated by capital. Just like under the church, I have the little theory that the liberal capitalism, as long as it's as much a totalitarian framework like state socialism, like fascism, like the old type of aristocratic states.
He's
called them states because there's this one dogma, which was before it was the church, and the art had to work for the church. So later came the bourgeoisie, the art had to work for the bourgeoisie, now it's the capital, the pure money, the brands, which are just agents of the money.
Yeah.
In fact, they're agents of the economy. Mm-hmm. A brand is an agent of the economy, and in the end, the fact that, for example, a brand, and also a brand like Banksy, when you talk about the brand like Banksy, how does it become such a brand? By the numbers, by the money that's paid for it, that values it. I mean, then you have these niche subcultures where we value stuff way higher, that makes way less money. But on a general societal level, on the stuff that will be will go down in the art history is of course it's dictated by the power that be, and the power that be in a capitalist society is the capital. I think I don't want to be like moralistic about it, but you have to be realistic about it.
I mean,
can I ask you something? Because now you say that all art is capitalist, but when I am in Barcelona or pretty much any city in Europe and I go to an art space, it's usually government sponsored. Like, I live next to a museum that is paid for by the Ayuntamiento. I think it's for a very big part of government that curates art, no?
It's
pay top dollar for an art piece, but they are the ones deciding who gets an exhibit and who not, for a big part.
There's some truth to it, but maybe I argued a little bit too extreme, but the effect that art that has found the money will be incorporated in official art history by art historians is something that can be traced throughout the industrial age, throughout the 20th century, very much. For example, you had this art critic Clement Greenberg, who was like the critic of the abstract expressionism New York school. He coined this term of the umbilical cord of gold. So the artist could only become actually relevant when they found the patron, and there is this effect is somewhere at play. I know there's a contradiction between the public art houses and the public and academic art historians who have an ideal also to be free of that and maybe to argue for a different type of art. So they are a little there. Yes, you are right. They are a little bit in competition with the market, but in the end, it flows a little bit into one also. They have the art historians have I have heard somebody from the museum sphere saying that this power is rapidly declining compared to the market power also. It's of course it's all like a theory, but this interplay is there, but I think if you take the test on the if you test with the contrary and ask are there any artists in the modern age who are considered super important for the art history and whose work is not valuable in economic terms. I think it's pretty hard to find any.
Yeah, you can go.
I mean, you always can think that there is a very talented artist that deserves to be in a higher position than it is. That's all for recon and in terms of the value of their works. That is a very personal option, very personal choose. We all can think that this specific artist deserves to be there.
For sure.
An extra zero in the sales.
Yes, and but then you are again at the point.
Yeah.
If you manage to get him there, or her, or it, it will be underlined, finalized, realized by that extra zero in a sense. Mm-hmm. So this. Yeah, it's more complicated than I was polemically proposing.
If you put it in the form of threat to the article, just out of curiosity, and after this I'll stop. But what do you consider a great threat? Like the money that's perverting the article that's like sort of what speculates best and what will grow most in value, or the government that decides what fits in our ideological ideals and therefore we display, like which to use a great threat. Because I think the government is scarier than big money. Big money just wants to make more money, but the government wants to push an ideology through curating.
Yeah, but the government has bad taste.
So.
Yeah,
exactly.
And in the end,
it
tries
also,
like, look, for example, of it was like also a city hall decision not to make a lengthy show, and it's a non-authorized exhibition, as I know, mm-hmm. from the artist. So it's also a question. There starts also more what is the usual city government, especially left orientated in this sense. Yeah. Mm. So we're talking about also questionizing where are these values, where are which value. So I think also basic issues, maybe not.
Well, the Vatican exhibition is to promote tourism, not
promote art. Yeah, yeah.
Terrorism.
Also, but then we have, for example, downstairs the case of the. The Shadowman piece from the Hakankara collection. For example, this piece was made in the very end of Richard Hamilton's life, and he was struggling at that time. And I don't remember the cipher that the collector paid for this artwork, because it was done on an action painting thing. Purpose on a specific place, and all of a sudden this artist died, and all these all this artwork just rise up as all artists that artists are happens to, you know. So there are things that they never change in that terms.
Yes, yes. I also, it was not really, I think it's too simple to think of it as a threat. I just wanted to stress that it's something you also have to always keep in the back of the mind when it's when one will speak about the importance of art or the effect of art or the art as such can is not a great tool to bring the change in the very direct way. In my opinion, art is a
testifies that change in a way.
It testifies. It's it can trace. It can prefigure. I think most importantly, it can open up possibilities. But also, I think it's good art is never an answer. Good art is just posing a question. Maybe good art is one of the last things in our society holding up the flame of the ideal of the open society, of the open discourse. Maybe. I don't know. I didn't want to say it's a bad threat and there's a way better model there. It's just like the opposite. I don't want to be fooled into thinking that in our specific system and in our specific moment, the relationship between art and art valuation and the powers is something else than in other systems.
Yeah.
At least not completely.
Let's have a cover.
Thank you.